Greetings for the day. Welcome to another session of Compure Networks. My name is Muhammad Rahmat Ali. Today we are going to learn about the Sun RPC. In the last session we studied about the RPC or remote procedure calls, the type of RPCs and what are the different mechanisms involved in RPC. In today's session we are going to learn about Sun RPC. The Sun RPC was being developed by the Sun RPC company, and it is now been called as open source remote processing call or open source network type of a thing. Now, in today's session, we're going to learn about the Sun RPC and what are the transparency issues in Sun RPC and the other parts. Now coming forward, what are the main things involved in RPC? The Sun RPC package consists of four components. There are four major components with reference to the Sun RPC. What is the first one? RPC or XDR protocol. What do you mean by the XDR? XDR means Extension Directory Reserve protocol, or Extension Directory Register, I guess, protocol. This protocol is used for client-server communication and language for describing the client-server interface. It describes the client-server interface of the system. And this protocol is majorly being used in client-server application and a language for describing the client-server's interface. The second one is RPCGen. This is a program that translates the description of the client server interface into a server and a client stub routine. Now, in the previous session also I told you about the stub, and you will learn more about this stub in your software engineering and also in software testing if at all if you have a subject. In this you will be having this concept called a stub. This stub is nothing but a dummy type of a thing which will help you to execute that particular task. Which will help you to execute that particular task. That is what we call as a stub. So RPCGen is a program that translates the description of a client server interface into server and client stub routines. In the sense, when a server is sending a request to the client, or when the client is sending the request to the server, it converts all of this translation or the description among these two things. That is what we call as RPCGen. The third one is a runtime library which is used to make all work, in the sense how this will take into communication and how the server will take an interaction with the client and how client will reply to the server. These all things and all the library required for this has been taken care of this Sun RPC. And the last one is the port mapper, a Sun RPC program that handles some transparency issues. Now what do you mean by these transparency issues? There are a lot of transparency issues with reference to the Sun RPC and other of the things. So what are the major transparency issues with reference to Sun RPC? We'll see in the coming slides. What are the different slides which are coming? We'll see into it. Now, what are the transparency issues? The transparency issue is, in an ideal world, we should simply be able to replace our local procedure call with a client stub on the client end and a server stub on the server end. In practice, this is not possible. Like, see, to give you an example, I'll tell you all these things. When we are, like, see, we both are into a conversation. I'm recording this video or clip at my convenience, at my place. But you are seeing this video at your convenience. So it means, I am, in other terms, teaching you at your comfort zone, at your comfort zone. But what actually is happening, I am recording this video at my convenience and you are listening it at your convenience. In other terms, if at all if you literally see it, we are having a one-to-one conversation when you are seeing this video. But actually, I have recorded this session at my place. So this is a bit complicated, but to make you understand, this is what this transparency issue is talking about. In an ideal world, we should simply be able to replace our local procedure call with a client stub, or the client stub on the server end. In the sense, the client stub will be on client end and the server stub will be at the server end. In the sense, when I am recording this video, I know the environment, I know the place. But what you are seeing, you are seeing only the things which is been visible through this particular camera. I know the environment where I am sitting and recording this video. You know the environment where you are sitting and watching this video. So, client at client side, server at server side, or server at server side, client and client side. So this is what you call as the transparency issues. Now see, what is the issue over here? If at all if I am teaching you, it means that it is a one-to-one conversation, but actually it is not a one-to-one conversation, it is many-to-one conversation or many-to-many conversation, but at your side it is looking like a one-to-one conversation. When the video is on the internet, many people see this video. So to whomever I am addressing, I will be addressing that particular person, or whoever is watching that video, I will be addressing that particular person to communicate. So this creates a transparency issue. Why? Because this video was actually been made for the particular class of IIT 5th semester, but also other people are also watching this video, might be watching this video. So this creates a transparency issue. So to make you understand, I have given you this example to make you understand what actually the transparency issues. I have told you all of these things. I hope you understood the things at your side. Now, what is service numbering? See, these all are the general terms with reference to Sun RPC. We can skip those terms, but also we'll be learning all these things so that you can understand what actually the things are. Now, what it says, when programmer specify the RPC interface, they assign a service number to the service they create. Now what it does, thus it is the programmer's responsibility to ensure that the number he or she uses does not clash with numbers being used by other service on that machine or potentially any other machine in the network. It should really be system's responsibility to ensure unique numbers are assigned. If the numbers are used at all in the ANSA system, for example, a service registers its properties with a trader and client looks for a server with the required properties. Now what this all things is all about? If I explain you these things in a simpler way, this goes to your roll number. See, there might be some duplicate names with reference to the students. For example, there can be n number of Ali in one class. There can be n number of Khans in one class. There can be n number of people with the same name in a class. But what will be unique among them? The unique thing among them will be their roll numbers. Their roll numbers. And how will they be identified? Either they will be identified with reference to the roll numbers or with their father name. This creates a unique property that is been registered already. If my name is Ali, I am the son of my father whose name is somewhat like Ali. So I am the registered one. I am the son of my father and you are the son of your parents. You are the daughter of your parents. It says some assignment to it. It has some unique property. Your name, your family name plays a unique property. So whenever a service number is giving, it should be unique. If at all if it has been duplicated, a duplicate number will be generated, which will create a problem. For example, two people has the same roll number. When one is coming, another is not coming, the attendance will be given to only one person, though he is coming or not, that attendance will be given to the person whose actually roll number belongs to. So this is what we call as service numbering. The next one is the transport protocol. What is the transport protocol? In theory, Sun RPC could be layered over any transport protocol, but in practice, the runtime libraries supplied only support TCP and UDP. A particular protocol must be chosen by the programmer, and the choice of protocol can affect the semantics of the call. If UDP is chosen, then the total size of argument and total size of result must be less than the maximum UDP packet size, which is most implementation in 8192 bytes. TCP has no size restrictions on parameters or results. This is the reference to the transport protocol with reference to TCP and UDP. We have seen what is TCP and UDP in the previous sessions. Now, if at all if you have not seen the video, you can check the playlist, and you can check the video with reference to TCP and UDP. The next point is the RPC library supports a broadcast procedure call, so any server on the local network can reply, but only for RPC over UDP. This is with reference to the transport protocol. This is very simple. Like as you can see from the presentation, this is very simple. We'll skip this. Now, what do you mean by parameter passing? What do you mean by parameter passing with reference to the normal thing? Like passing of the values. Now, what it says, RPC supports the passing of only a single parameter and the return of only a single result. Though these parameters and results could be structures containing several data items, the only parameter passing model support is call by value. Now, the next point is, of course, remote procedure calls cannot have side effect. They cannot access global variables. This you can understand with reference to the programming: call by value, global variables, local variables, and all these things. If at all, if you keenly observe here, what do you mean by a global variable? If at all, if we consider a global variable, then that value will be global to everyone. What is the global value of gravity? It is same for everything. It is a global value. It cannot be changed. So that is what that is accessible to everyone. Okay. Now, the next one is the data representation. The data representation in XDR protocol, an XDR function generated by RPC gen handles any differences in data representation from machine to machine. Now, what it is, the client and server stubs automatically uses this routine to encode and decode parameters and results. The next one is, there are limits on the data structures that can be represented in XDR. Extension data representation. Okay. Note that the representation chosen in XDR mainly suits Sun machines, so that XDR is inefficient when used to transmit data between two machines that, for example, both uses little Indian integers. Okay. Now, this is the general thing with reference to the RPCs. Now, the next one is binding and location transparency. Now, what it is, in the local case, the caller knows which procedure it is using, as they were bounded together at compile time. In a remote procedure call, the caller must find the process providing the services it desires. Now, in Sun RPC, this is accomplished by calling the port mapper service. The RPC library contains functions that will do a lookup on the port mapper when the client is initialized. So, the client can then send its RPC request to appropriate TCP or UDP port. This is very common. Like if at all if you read these things, you will get an idea how things will work with reference to RPC. Like, you know, I'm not explaining you in detail, so like, you know, to waste the time. Everything has been clearly mentioned on the slides. Now, the next one is, note, however, that the caller must specify which machine it wants to connect to find the service. If it is not known in advance which machine the service will be on, then the programmer must include codes to send a broadcast RPC to the port mapper on all machines. See, this is all been said with reference to sending the request and getting back the request. In RPC, you should always remember, when the sender is sending the request to the receiver cannot send back the request to the sender until and unless the sender completes its request and the receiver receives every of the information. Then the receiver will send the request to or information to the sender, and until then the sender cannot pass any of the values or any of the requests to the receiver. Okay, and all these things, how it is happening with reference to the protocol, with reference to the binding, with reference to the other things, it is been mentioned over here in this presentation or in this things. Now, replication, transparency. What do you mean by this? A system designer may choose to have several replicated server instances for reasons of performance or reliability. The Sun RPC protocol provides no direct support for this system. The system designer will have to ensure client broadcast when looking for a service, like the last section that we have seen. And we will have to come up with a way for replicated servers to stay in or step with each other. Moving forward, what are failure handling? What are the, like, you know, what do you mean by failure handling, and what are actually the failure handlings if at all something happens? In local case, the client need only examine the return code to determine the success of the operation. In the RPC case, as can be seen in like rpcclient.c, there's a file which says the return status of RPC library function must be examined to determine if a return code was even received from the server. This is all about with reference to the failure handlings of with reference to the Sun RPC in what you call as Sun RPC type of a things. Now, this all will tell you what Sun RPC is all about and how things will be working around. So what it says, the Sun RPC implementation is not resilient to failure of the port mapper. If the port mapper fails, new server will not be able to register themselves. The client will not be able to find running servers, so all RPC will time out unsatisfied. In practice, even the port mapper was restarted, all the running servers would have been restarted so they could register themselves with the new port mappers. So the only way to recover properly is to reboot the system. Now, what do you mean by this port mapper? If you see the four things that we have mentioned over here, you see this, all the four things, RPC, XGA protocol, RPC gen, a runtime library, and port mapper, this will help you to establish a connection with reference to the Sun RPCs. Okay, now if at all the port mapper, what do you mean by port mapper? Port mapper will map the call remotely. The port mapper will map the call remotely from client to server and server to client. If at all, like, see, it is something like you are a telephone operator. The moment you dial a number, your number will be broadcasted on the network, and that call will be to the registered mobile number to which you are calling. For our convenience, we are giving the number, but on the network, it has some unique value. It has some unique value, and sometimes due to overlapping of the unique ID, you will be, you know, rolled out to a wrong number. This happens generally. If at all this happens, what we'll do, we will drop the call and again we will try. That's the same thing it is saying. We need to restart the system to register all of the port mappers or all of the servers to themselves. Now the next one is the security one. So in the local case, the caller of a function can be sure that it is calling an authorized provider of the service, and the procedure can be sure it is called by an authorized user because they are linked together at compile time. When the server and the client are interacting with one another, in general terms, we'll be having a handshake type of a protocol in which the server will confirm the client, and the client will confirm the server whether they are connecting with a proper channel. Now, what it says further, With a remote call, neither party can be sure to assure the client and server that they are talking to authorized server and client. RPC includes an authentication mechanism. The client sends its credentials and a verifier to the server with RPC call. The server returns its own verifier with the results. The standard authentication method provided by the libraries are null, Unix, shorts and DES, but it is easy to add new methods. Okay, what actually it is like, see, when I am speaking to you, like, let me consider, if at all, if I am speaking something with reference to computer networks and I am not from a computer background, will you listen to me at first? No, you will not listen to me at first. Why? Because as I am not having a background of computer science, I cannot teach you computer networks. But a student who is having, or a faculty who is having a degree in computer networks can explain you much better than a person who is non-computer networks background. Okay, so this is the thing. And when we are confirmed with one another, when I am satisfied with you and you are satisfied with me, then only we will have a proper communication. Then only we will have a proper communication. The next point is, using the authentication mechanism is not transparent. It requires some extra programming on the client server's side. Now, the transparency issues in RPCs, Sun RPCs. What are the transparency issues? The Sun RPC mechanism makes network programming easier. However, it falls far short of making remote procedure call transparent to the programmers. Now, what actually do you mean by this? See, when we are making a remote procedure call, as the name suggests, it is remote. Like, how can I say? The way the question is asked to you in a Viva, for an instance, I'm telling you, the question which has been asked in Viva is based on the student's ability. If at all the student is answering very well, then the level of questions will be getting changed. If the students are not able to answer the question correctly, then the level of question will also be different. So it means, though we know the procedure, but it is not transparent. It is not transparent in the sense, I may ask one question to one person, which might be very much easier for him, though he is studying very well. The same question I will ask to another student, that will be a difficult for him, because he doesn't have that much of knowledge with reference to that particular topic. So though it is the same thing, but it is not transparent with reference to the things. In the same way, the RPC mechanism makes network programming easier. However, it falls short of making remote procedure calls transparent to the programmers. Now, due to the performance penalties, RPC should not be used in applications that requires a large amount of data transfer between clients and servers. Okay. Now, this is the transparency issues and RPCs. Now, what are the advantages of remote procedure calls? What are the different advantages with reference to the remote procedure calls? What is the first one? Remote procedure call supports process oriented and threat oriented model. See, this is the thing that you will be learning in your operating system. If at all, if you have the subject called as operating system, there you will have a concept called as process and thread. Okay, just to make you aware what this is all about. Process is a collection of major operations that need to be performed. Then what do you mean by a thread? Thread is the smallest individual unit of a program, or the smallest individual part of a program that need to be executed is thread. If you remember, in Java also you have thread programming, you have thread synchronization, and also in your operating system you have this subject called as thread and process. For a general thing, thread is lighter than process. Thread is very lighter than with reference to the process. So remote procedure call supports process oriented and thread oriented models. The second one is, the internal message passing mechanism of RPC is hidden from the user. Like, it is obvious, like, that's only the reason it is remote procedure call. The third one is the effort to rewrite and redevelop the code is minimum in remote procedure call. Why? Because to relocate the services and to redesign the services, it is very easy because it is in remote way and different servers will respond to different applications. See, for an instance, like, you know, to make you understand, you have an email address of Gmail, but you don't own the Gmail. When you open Gmail, the whole of the application from the server will come and reside on your local system. Then only you are able to access your Gmail. True? Yes, it's true. Why? Because you cannot access a Gmail from your system. Why? Because there is nothing like installed in your Gmail. There is nothing like installed in your Gmail, but still you are able to access that Gmail. Why? Why? Because that particular server comes and reside onto your system, then only you are able to access Gmail, Yahoo, Reddit, whatever it is. Now, the next point is, remote procedure calls can be used in distributed environment as well as the local environment. Okay, this is very simple. The last point is, many of the protocol layers are omitted by RPC to improve the performance. Okay, now the last one, the disadvantages of remote procedure call. What are the disadvantages? The remote procedure call is a concept that can be implemented in different way. It is not a standard one. It can be implemented in a different way, like I have told you. Like, the same thing can be different for others. For me, if I ask you, for me, everything is security. For you, everything can be cloud. For other person, everything will be virtualization. For other person, everything will be big data. For other person, it can be anything. So it is not a standard, but everyone is studying computer science. Everyone is doing some of the participation in computer science department, though we are having a different thing. So it is not a standard that if you know this particular things like C, C++, Java, Oracle, security, then only you will be considered as a computer science graduate. No, there is no particular standard, but everyone is contributing by their own side. This is the disadvantage with reference to the remote procedure call. Now, there is no flexibility in RPC for hardware architecture. It is only interaction based. And the last point is, there is an increase in cost because of remote procedure call. The cost of the remote procedure call is much in reference to local procedure calls or local calls. Okay, now these are the advantages and disadvantages of remote procedure call. I hope you understood something with reference to RPCs, the different types of RPCs, sun-RPC, advantages, disadvantages, with reference to security, with reference to binding of the data, with reference to different things. If you have any doubt with reference to this particular topic, you can reach me out at ramath_ali@yahoo.com. Or you can visit the college in college hours and clear your doubts at the college premises. That's all for now. Have a great time. Have a great day. See you in the next session. This was the last class of your third unit. In the next session, we'll start with the fourth unit. Thank you for now. See you in the next session.